Good morning, everybody. How are we doing this blessed morning? It's sunny or gray out there, one of the two. Not quite sure yet. It's Thanksgiving week, so everybody should be getting ready for that. It's a beard, too. Thank you, Tennille. Yes, it is. I only have about another week of it left, so we'll get through that. But we're glad you guys are here with us today in person. We're glad you guys are with us at home. Thank you so much for our faithful attenders. Thank you for all the comments you're putting on Facebook as well, letting us know what's working, what's not working. Thank you for just helping us serve you. As we go through, all the announcements, as we say each week, are on our Facebook page, Twitter, the church app. If you were on the Facebook page this week, you saw the picture of Operation Christmas Child. All the boxes were on there. We actually got to make a Christmas tree out of them. So thank you for bringing your boxes in on time and getting them here so that we could bless people throughout the world. So thank you so much for that. Giving, you can continue to give in the ways that we have through mailing it in, through our giving stations, which are at our exits, through the church website or the church app. And each week we do our best to make sure you guys are aware of the things that go on due to your giving. And, you know, we talk about the things that happen outside of here, but it's important that we highlight the things that happen here too. If you walk through the parking lot today, you should have noticed that there was salt everywhere, right? And salt costs money. And plowing costs money. So your tithes and offerings are going to help us get through this Christmas, winter, snowy season and make sure that everybody's safe while they're going through our parking lots and things. So thank you for continuing to give and know that it's going there and several other places. You have warmth under your feet because there's heating in the floor. We were blessed to have so many great things because of the giving that happens here, so thank you. If you have a child who needs to receive services, Res Kids services are located on their YouTube channel. Please make sure your children are tuning into those services. There's great messages there each week. Miss Lynn's doing a good job of posting them. And we want to make sure that our kids are getting fed while Res Kids is paused. You know, we don't want to just take care of ourselves. We got to be building up our children because our children are their future. And we got to get the seeds inside of them so that they can go and flourish in this dark world that they live in. So make sure that our kids are getting their services. Quest service is in person over there, and then it'll be posted on Tuesdays at 9 o'clock in the morning on our YouTube channel as well. Housekeeping notes, this is going to sound a little bit ridiculous, okay? And I'm sorry, but it's something we've got to do. We've got to do it from the front. As we all know, COVID numbers are going a little hayward right now, right? Everybody's on high alert, and we should be. We need to be cautious. We need to be smart. So we're asking you, you go through a screening when you reach our doors. You get your temperature taken. They ask you questions. But we'd ask that you do that at home before you even come through the doors. And be honest with yourself, right? Am I feeling good today? Or am I going to be a little selfish and just go because I got a sniffle? I'm going to say it this way. This is the way it works for me. It's not all about you. Right? Let's think about everybody else who comes through our doors and be overly cautious for them. Okay? Because we don't want anything to happen. And most importantly, we don't want to have to close so the people who can attend a person aren't able to. So we'd ask that you go through that screening yourself. What does that screening look like? Do you have any signs or symptoms, right? Are you exhibiting a fever? Have you traveled out of state? And have you gone through the protocol you need to be able to get back into service? If you got questions about what that is, you can go to the CDC website or the New York State Forward website, and that information's there. Have you had a possible exposure? This is the big thing that's going on, okay? There's exposures everywhere, a secondary exposure. You might not have tested positive, but somebody you know has. Go through the exposure process. If you've been quarantined by the Department of Health, abide in that because there's authorities that are over us. If you think you've been exposed, think about how serious it is and if you should stay home or not, okay? Because the best thing is we have it available still. It's available online, so we don't have to put anybody at risk. I know this is what we're hearing everywhere, but we're going to hear it here too because it's a common theme right now. Hold on, I'm going to turn around. Please do your best to arrive at service early and on time so we can start at exactly 10:30. Thank you. Guys, we love you all, and I know that there's nothing easy whatsoever as the getting here on time because the enemy gets in the way. He does. He'll find any way possible, especially when you have children and things like that. Children that where you got it. My wife came right down the aisle when I said this earlier. And I said, hi. But the thing is we want to be able to start online on time. It's not for the people who are here. You guys are all going to get it. The people at home are waiting. It's like a silent, dead thing that goes on. We have music that plays till exactly 10:30. When 10:30 hits, it's a blank screen until we start. So for their sake and for anybody who's watching us for the very first time, has never been through our doors, that's the first impression they get. They don't start on time. Must not be important to them. So continue to do our best. We know the weather's going to be changing. Set yourselves a little bit more time and things like that. It's on all of us. And most importantly, just know you're giving your best effort, and that's all we ask for you to do. If for some reason you go out into the foyer and you see somebody who's waiting at the doors after 8:40 or 10:40, please know that those doors aren't to be opened other than by the head usher. They're going to let that person in, go through the same protocols you've gone through so that everybody in here can be safe. And continue to do your best to remain in your seats. If you have to leave your seat to go to the restroom or whatever it may be, please just try to take the least evasive way, cross as few people as possible, and then we'll get through with that. However, there's always good things that are going on, but we need to recognize them, right? I talked about all this awful stuff, all this stuff that we all want to get past, but there's good things that go on. We have to look to our good things each and every day, okay? This week's Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is good. I don't care if you like potatoes, if they be instant or mashed. I don't care if you like sweet potatoes. I don't care if you eat turkey or ham on Thanksgiving. My daughter says nobody should be able to eat ham on Thanksgiving. It should only be turkey. But whatever it may be, there's something good that goes on this week and is going on right now. But we have to recognize it, okay? The times we are in, it's so easy to recognize all the bad, all the discomforts, all the things that don't work well for us. We just need to change our focus and focus on all the great things that are happening and all those other things. They'll still be there, but they won't have prevalence in your life. So as we look at our scripture for today, it's from Psalms. It's 100, verse 4. It's up there. Go through his open gates with great thanksgiving. Enter his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. We had that opportunity this morning. You're in his house. We can raise to our feet, and we can thank him for everything we have. So please stand up for praise and worship.
Worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Freedom.
Cross is my beginning, the line drawn in the sand, the end of all my striving. Now I am born again. There Jesus was forsaken. Grace is my salvation, the gift of God, the work of Calvary. It is done,
it is finished.
Christ has won,
he is risen.
Grace is here, love is
Jesus.
Grace is here. the sinner's restless heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. So
to tell you, I am so grateful that God loves me. God loves you. God loves us all. And he'll never stop loving us. He always has. And you're looking at me like, why do you still have your mask on? Because I don't care. All right? I'm going to tell you something. I don't care. I do not like wearing these masks. Every time I breathe in to take a breath to be able to sing out to God, it sucks into my mouth. It's distracting. It's disturbing. But God's worth it. I want to praise God no matter what. You know, the Bible says that if we don't praise God, the rocks and the stones will cry out. I have to tell you, not on my watch. Not when I'm around. I will tell you, a number of years ago, I had a state trooper come to the hospital where I was laying in the ICU, and he looked me in the eyes and he said, "Thank you for not dying." Now, you may not have had that happen, but I will tell you, from that point in my life, I look at all the things I've been able to experience still here, and I would have gone to heaven, But I have had so many wonderful things. Has it all been easy? No. But I'll tell you, I'm so grateful God has done what he's done in my life and continues to do it. And I am going to worship him and praise him no matter what goes on because he's worthy. All the time, all the time, all the time. That was nice. Well, I don't know if you can be seated. You can, but before you do, go ahead and just wave to somebody, greet somebody, and have a seat. I'm so grateful to be able to worship and praise God, you know, with other Christians, whether we're here, whether you're online. You know, it's good to be able to connect in something bigger than yourself. Because God has you. As a Christian, you are connected in the body of Christ. It's not just the body of Christ here at RLC or in Rome or in New York or in the United States. This is across the world that you are connected with something so big, something so amazing. And we many times don't recognize that we are truly a part of the body of Christ, of the kingdom of God, in a time that is monumental. You know, the Bible says that the people, back in the days that we read about in the Bible, they looked at the days you and I live in, and they longed to be in these days because of the amazing things that God is doing. And you may say, but I see all this other stuff. Jeremy already encouraged you. We can choose what we look at, right? And if you want to look for the bad, how many of you know you'll find it? There's no lack of bad. But I have to tell you something, that as much as there is bad, there's even more good. Well, how can you say that? Because this is what the Bible says, where sin abounds. Is sin abounding? The Bible says grace much more abounds. We should be able to see God everywhere all the time. In the midst of the most difficult things, the Bible says when the enemy comes in, is he trying to come in? Trying to get place in the world and in the things that are going on? Absolutely. But it says when the enemy comes in, like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. Now, you may say, well, I've never heard it said that way because I've always heard when the enemy comes in like a flood. Well, you say it your way and I'll say it my way. I know the enemy's going to come in, but like a flood, God's going to raise up a standard, something that's immovable, unshakable. And that's what we need to have in these days. I'm excited about God. And I hope you are, because God's excited about you. And this isn't something I just do here, you know, on Sunday morning when I get in front of people. This is something I do when nobody else is around. I worship God. I shout to God. I am so grateful for God. I don't know how anybody that's a Christian can't be excited about what God has done for them and what God is doing for them and what God wants to do. Because what does God want to do for you? What does Jeremiah 29:11 say? Anybody remember that? I know the plans God has for me. Plans for good. And when God says it's good, understand, when God says it's good, it's the best. It's the best. And not for evil, with a future and a hope. You know, there are so many people, even Christians, that are looking at what's ahead, and they're starting to get scared. Fear is starting to grip them. They're stressing out. Listen, you as a Christian, you don't have to stress out about the future because God's already in your future. God has a plan for you for good and not for evil, with a future and a hope. And that hope isn't a questionable expectation like hope in the world. People say, well, I hope we're going to have ice cream. See, some of you, I just got your attention. You're like, ice cream? They aren't sure they're going to get it. But in the biblical sense of the word hope, that actually is defined as a confident expectation of good. You can have a confident expectation that there's good ahead for you because God's ahead of you. And the Bible says every good and perfect gift comes from him. The best come from God. God's not going to give you less than the best because he can't. Everything God does is the best. It's perfect. It's the best. And we should be excited. You know, I hope you're excited here. You know, I hope you showed up with an expectation that God's going to speak to you today. God's going to do something in your life. I'm believing that God's going to bring healing to people here, healing to people at home, that he's going to drop a word in you. He's going to encourage you today, that you're not going to leave here, and you're not going to be the same at home because God's with you. God's right there to make your life better than you could ever imagine or dream. And that's where we've been learning about Scripture. It was a prophecy by Isaiah in the book of Isaiah. Isaiah was a prophet in Israel. It was during a very difficult time in Israel's existence. They were under captivity. It was dangerous. It was difficult. It was similar to what's going on with us today. How many of you know the Bible is not just an old word for old times? And if that's what you think, then you'll not have the benefit that God has for you. God's word is timeless. The Bible says heaven and earth will pass away, but his word will not pass away. Everything seen and unseen was created by the word of God. God's word still has power. Power to heal. Power to bring wisdom and understanding. Power to set free. And today, that's what God wants to do in your life here, in your life at home. Wherever people are and the word of God is going forth, there is the potential for transformation. But it's determined by what we're going to do with the word of God. And so today, I'm going to be, again, going back to the book of Isaiah. We're going to look at the portion of scripture that we started with last week. And I just want to pray, if you just close your eyes. Now, don't just check out and start thinking about lunch. Or go to the kitchen if you're at home for another cup of coffee. Let's just pray and let's invite God to do what only he can do. Because whatever God does is going to be best. It's going to be supernatural. It's going to be life-changing. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for your presence here. Thank you for the plan that you have that's for good, the best. Thank you for the power you have available to us right now to experience your truth, your word that's truth, coming forth and setting us free in areas of our life. Your word that is a light unto our path and a lamp unto our feet that gives us illumination and revelation to bring forth transformation, real change in our lives. Father, you have said you designed and desired us to go from faith to faith and glory to glory. And Father, we expect it to happen in this service today, whether people are at home or in person. There's no distance or time in the Spirit. And Father, we thank you that your word is life and health to those who find it. Father, today we thank you as your word goes forth, there'll be healings, physical healings, emotional healings, mental healings, spiritual healings, relational healings. Father, bring health and life in abundance because, Jesus, that's why you came, to give us life and life more abundant. So have your way in our lives and through our lives, in this place and at home for those that are listening. And we give you all the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen, amen. You know, there is not a day that we should not be opening our eyes with a heart of anticipation, a heart of expectation, because that's really what God has for us. Every day is a new day. Every day is a great opportunity for us to know God and make God known. I'm talking about the creator of the universe, everything seen and unseen. I don't know who your best friend is, but they can't do nearly what God can do. Yeah. Can I ask you a question? If you're not excited about God, how can you get anybody else excited about God? If we don't have a deep love for God, a great desire for God, then I can tell you why we're here is not going to happen, because we're here to be witnesses. Now, I'm not talking about something fake or something phony, putting on an air or a shell. I'm talking about when we really have a revelation of how awesome God is and how much he loves us and how much he wants to do for us. You can't help but get enthusiastic about God. And the world needs to see the church in love with God, in love with the Lord. And nobody can do that for you. But again, like you've already heard, part of it is by what we're focused on. Because we can't ignore the fact that we live in a fallen world. That this year, this has been the most challenging year I think all of us have ever lived. But where the challenges are, there's opportunities. And I did a message called Advertunities, adversities that are opportunities to see God. And the challenge is, are you looking for him? Or are you just seeing the stuff that's going on? Because God's working. God is really working. Just like he was working in Israel in the time of the prophet Isaiah. And we began to look in chapter 43, verse 18 and 19. We're going to go back to that and just kind of revisit it as we go through and make some things clear. The prophet said, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of what? Old. Okay, now, the prophet Isaiah was writing this, but he was speaking on behalf of who? God. I want you to know this was written in the present imperative. Okay? I didn't know that. I'm not smart enough to know that. I read somebody who is smart enough. And I didn't even understand it at that. So when I began to dig deeper and understand what they were saying, the present imperative is it's something that's always now. It's always going on. And imperative, if something's imperative, what is it? It's urgent. It's important. So the present imperative is a command, something that's urgent that should be going on constantly. Okay? So when he's saying this on behalf of God and saying, don't remember the former things, don't consider the things of old. And we last week realized that Israel was robbed of the things God had for them because they were looking back. And I shared with you a couple of quotes. Stephen Covey, who wrote The 7 Traits of Highly Effective People, said the enemy of best is often good. And John D. Rockefeller said, don't be afraid to give up the good to go for the great or the best. And so sometimes we're looking back and missing what God has for us right now. And we're looking back and it's robbing us of the anticipation and expectation, the hope of the future that God has for us. And that's the enemy's work. He's here to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and life more abundant. And so we have to see that this is what precedes verse 19. And it says, behold, I'll do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. But to understand this, we need to realize verse 18 has to happen before verse 19 can occur. Does that make sense? We have to let go, not remember or look back or consider the former things, and then go on to the next. Because if we're looking back, what would it be like if we spent our life looking back at our lives, trying to go through it? Well, we'd miss the great things that are going on in our present, and we'd have no clue about how good it's going to be in the future. And we'd be robbed of that. And so right here, we see this, we recognize this, but we want to get on to, but we've got to do the first things. Don't remember the former things, don't consider the things of old, because those things can rob us of what God has for us. And God has an ever-evolving, ever-increasing process that he has for us to go through. And he says, I'm going to take you from faith to faith and glory to glory. If it's one level of glory and another glory, is it the same level? No. God is ever increasing the glory. God wants whatever was best in your life today, he's got something even better tomorrow. And the reason why is he wants your life more blessed each day so you can bless more people. You can impact more people. He wants you to be blessed, but he also wants you to be a blessing. So today we're going to pick it up in verse 19 and really kind of dissect this. And what's the first word there? Behold. That's not a word that I use often. Is it a word you use often? But it's the word God, in the word of God, it occurs quite often. Behold, behold. So what does behold mean? Well, it actually means to become alert to. Be alert to something. Be fixing your focus and your attention to recognize or take note. So if it says behold, it's kind of a, hey, look at this. Be aware of this. Be fixed on this. And if we're not beholding something, then we're kind of just gazing at everything. And it's just not as crisp as God would have it. You know, in the scripture, the word behold is found in the New Testament. At the birth of Jesus, in Luke chapter 2, the angel of the Lord is speaking to the shepherds in the field. And he says, behold, I bring you good news of great joy to all people. What is he saying? Take note. Be alert. Be aware. There's something that's happening. Was this an everyday occurrence the Savior was born? No, it wasn't. It was a monumental moment. And right here, this is a monumental moment. God wants us to really take focus, be alert, be aware, be able to recognize. Because we go through life and we look at things, but we can't see everything. As much as we see, we don't see everything. So we've got to choose what we're really going to look for. And unfortunately, too many people go through life looking at all the bad. And it just devastates them. But we can choose to look for God, because where is God? Everywhere. God is everywhere. He's working everywhere. Even in the midst of the most difficult situations, you know God's there. The psalmist said, if I make my bed in hell, you're still there. Why is it hell? Because they're not able to have what God has for them. It's the lack of what God has planned and prepared and provided. The absence of it. And so that's where right here, we need to behold, be alert, recognize, take note. In John chapter 1, verse 29, it says this. This was John the Baptist. He's out in the wilderness. He's baptizing people for the repentance of sin. And it says, the next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him. Now, who was Jesus to John? Anybody know? Cousin. Hey, cuz. Right? John saw Jesus. That's my cousin. There are other people out there, probably knew Jesus too. Hey, John, your cousin's here. But John says, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Take note, recognize, be alert to, be aware of, this is not just my cousin. It is his cousin, but there's more to what they're looking at than just John's cousin. Mary's kid. You know, the carpenter's son. If they just see Mary's kid, the carpenter's son, John's cousin, what do they get from that? Help me this morning. I need you to be thinking. Nothing. They get, well, it, not much, right? But if they see John's cousin, Mary's son, the carpenter's kid, but they recognize and they're alert to, this is the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. How does that impact their lives? Man, it's crazy. But it's the same view. But it's beholding. Behold the Lamb of God. Don't behold John's cousin. Don't behold Mary's kid. Don't behold the carpenter's son. Behold, be alert to, recognize. How are you recognizing Jesus today? Is he just somebody that you hear about when you come to church and you read about when you read your Bible? Or are you beholding the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world? Are you beholding the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Are you recognizing the one who conquered hell and death and the grave? Because how you behold, how you view affects what we receive. And that's why when I see people that, you know, they're like, yeah, I go to church. Well, I'm glad you go to church, but do you have a relationship with Jesus? The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the absolute complete victor in the universe. He's conquered the enemy. And he's offering you the victory that he has so that you can walk in it. Yeah, yeah, that's Jesus. It is him. But he's your Lord. He's the one that lives in you as a Christian by his Spirit. He takes up residence in you. And the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you and causes your body to be quickened. I'm saved. But what does that mean? How do you behold that? The salvation, the saving work of Christ. What do you recognize? What are you alert to? What are you anticipating? Because as a Christian, we ought to go through life with the highest level of anticipation and expectation. Because if we don't, nobody's going to want what you have. Nobody's going to care about your Jesus. And they need to, because he's the only one that can change their lives. Not just here, but for eternity. So, behold. Let's go back to verse 19 in Isaiah chapter 43. It says, behold. And then God's saying, I will do. Now, when God says he's going to do something, will he? Absolutely. The Bible says God's not a man that he should lie. So when God says he's going to do something, you can count on it. It's unlike any other experience you have had with any other human being throughout the course of your life. Because all of us human beings, I want to tell you a secret. So this is going to be worth you coming today, worth you tuning in today. People lie. But the other part of that is God never lies. God cannot say something and not do it. There's so much power in God's word. When he says something, things start to change, to line up with his word. And so he said, I'm going to do this. So you can count on it. You can be, without being disappointed, you can count that God's going to do. And what's he going to do? He's going to do good. Every good and perfect gift comes from him. He gives you everything that pertains to life and godliness. He's not done. You should have a great anticipation of what's about to come, because God is going to cause you to be overwhelmingly more than a conqueror in all things. What's your battle today? What are you facing? What obstacle, what opposition are you facing today? And are you recognizing that you're not facing it alone? The one who has never lost a battle is there with you and willing to fight for you. The Bible says God contends with those things that contend with you. He perfects those things that concern you. God has the best in mind for us. The best. It's whether we're going to allow God to have his way. And then it says, behold, I will do. And the next three words, a new thing. Thank you. Some of you are right now, I can't believe I went to church to hear a secular song. I have to tell you what happened. This week I was watching something. I don't even remember what it was. But this song came on. And I remembered this scripture, behold, I'll do a new thing. And I felt like God was saying, that's the way it's going to be. You enjoy this song from a secular point of view, but you need to enjoy it because I'm going to do a new thing. And the new thing I'm going to do is not like anything anybody's ever seen before. Amen. Man, you guys are making me work today. I'm telling you, when you get a hold of this, when you believe this, It's one thing for you to listen to me say this and see my enthusiasm, my excitement, my expectation, because I do. But you can walk out of here just the same way you came in. You can be at home just the same when this service goes, the message goes and ends. You can go back to what you were doing, or you can be changed, truly changed today. And listen, I'm not expecting you to be like me. I can't be like you. I can't be like anybody but who God made me. I'm a one of a kind. So are you. And I can't do you and you can't do me, but you need to do you, the best you that God has for you to be. And it should be, we have relationship, daily intimacy and interaction with the creator of the universe. If that's not exciting, check for a pulse. Because it is. It is exciting. It's amazing. But he says, behold, I'll do a new thing. When God says he's going to do a new thing, what he does is what nobody's ever seen before. When he took Israel into the promised land and out of the wilderness, when he took them through the Red Sea, the Bible says God knew the path that he was going to take them that no one else knew. No one knew that he was going to open the Red Sea, but God did. That was his plan. These new things that God wants to do, as much as it's a process and we go from glory to glory, there are moments in time that God does these absolutely amazing things. And he wants to do them in your life. He wants people to see God at work in your life and my life. And so he says, I'll do a new thing. And then he says, it will what? It shall. Oh, come on, help me. I mean, you got an open book. Now it shall spring forth. Now, when it says spring forth, what's the word picture? Because we think in pictures, we don't think in words. When something springs forth, what do you think? Right? I have to tell you, my wife had a big chuckle at me yesterday. We sat down and I had recorded a couple of things, and one of them I just brought up. We were sitting there together, and I said, oh, you know, I've got something we can watch. It was a pogo stick championship. Yep, I can see you're underwhelmed. It was these guys that are on these high-tech pogo sticks that are air-charged. They're jumping 12, 15 feet in the air. And when I was thinking about this, I was thinking, spring forth. It's going to come. When it springs forth, it's a suddenly. God does some suddenly things. In the New Testament, do you remember what God did suddenly? How about the outpouring of the Holy Spirit? The Bible says, suddenly there came a sound of a mighty rushing wind, and they were all filled with the Spirit. Was that a change? Absolutely. It was a monumental change. It was a world change that just occurred. Because God began to be involved in some people's lives in a way that was new. Oh, well, God's done everything he's going to do. No, he's not done. He's not done. You ain't seen nothing yet. The glory of the latter house, the latter days, you, the church, the glory that God has for you, the church, in these days far exceeds the glory that's been revealed up to this point in the earth. Oh my gosh. I'm not talking about just the Franklin Grahams. I'm talking about you. I'm talking about me. I'm talking about regular people that God wants to be able to work in their lives. Behold, I do a new thing, but you got to forget the old stuff. Don't keep looking back to that old stuff, because you're going to miss the greatest stuff, the best stuff. Oh yeah, that was good stuff, but God has the best stuff in store for you. God God won't push it on you. I'm not going to push it on you. You need to fight. You need to fight for what God has. Because the enemy is trying to pull it away. He's trying to deceive you into thinking you can't have this. And that's a deception. Where there's deception, there is loss. He's going to rip you off, what he does all the time. It'll spring forth, and it says, shall you not know it? Do this new thing, and it'll spring forth. Shall you not know it? A new thing. I share with you that many times it's the good things, the older things, that rob the best things. And we're gonna look today real quickly in the book of 2 Kings at a man. His name is Hezekiah. He was 25 years old when he became king of Judah. And we pick it up here, and it says he was 25 years old. He became king and reigned for 29 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Abi, the daughter of Zechariah. He did what was right in the sight of the Lord. Isn't that what we're supposed to be doing? We're supposed to be living in a life that is right in the sight of the Lord. Can we do that? Can you and I do that? If we choose to, right? But it's got to be intentional. It goes on to say, according to all that his father David had done, he removed the high places and broke the sacred pillars and cut down the wooden images. Now, right there, we look at that and we see that he removed the high places. He broke the sacred pillars and he cut down wooden images. Now, this is all about the idolatry that was in Judah. They were worshiping idols. And we don't know, we don't experience this much in this country, but when Debbie and I were in India, one of the things that we saw was these exact things, the high places, the sacred pillars, the wooden images, that there were altars all through the Himalayas. Right behind where we were staying, we could see a few of them up in the mountains, and we would hear people, you know, yelling and screaming. We would walk through paths, these trails in the mountains, where there were altars. There were little carved images. There were places they could take food and money and drink and things and worship their gods. And Hezekiah said, no, we're not doing this anymore. There's one true God, and we're getting rid of all the false gods, because worshiping a false god is deception. And where there's deception, there is loss. And so he got rid of all this stuff. How many of you think that was a good thing to do? Oh, come on, guys. It was. And then it goes on to say the next part of verse 4 is just shocking and striking. It says, and he broke in pieces the bronze serpent that Moses made. Now, does anybody remember that? The bronze serpent that Moses made? Moses, was he doing things God wanted or doing things against God? The Bible says he was a friend of God. And so he was doing what God wanted. And he made this bronze serpent. But now we find Hezekiah, who's taking care of all the idolatry, and he's breaking it in pieces. Now, we're going to jump to another portion of Scripture, but we're going to read the rest of this. It goes on to say, for until those days that the children of Israel burned incense to it, he trusted in the Lord God of Israel, so that after him none like him among the kings of Judah, nor were there before him, for he held fast to the Lord, and he did not depart from following him and keeping his commandments, which the Lord had commanded Moses. So Hezekiah was following what the Lord had told Moses, that Moses told Hezekiah and the people of Judah, and he kept on line, and he was trying to keep the people in line. And the Lord was with him, and he did what? Prospered. Keep reading. Prospered where? Now, dumb question, but is that anything you could use a little more of? You know, God's not a respecter of people. Your life can be what Hezekiah's was if we'll just align like Hezekiah did. If we'll honor God, if we'll get idolatry out of our lives. And you know, sometimes we idolize, we make idols out of things we worship, things we esteem highly, the past, what God has done, and we miss out on the best that he has for us right now. And so he broke the serpent, the bronze serpent on the staff that Moses made at the direction of God. And so we'll just jump back there to Numbers and look at this real quickly. Numbers chapter 21. Now, again, if you look at this, this is a portion of scripture where a lot of things were going on. But the people were out in the wilderness. A lot of things were happening that they didn't like, so they started complaining. You know how that happens when we get discouraged or disappointed about what we expected and it didn't happen the way we want, and so we think God's holding out on us. All of a sudden, that discouragement, that disappointment turned into complaining against God and complaining against Moses. And it says, the people came to Moses and said, we have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against you. And what resulted was these serpents came out, these deadly snakes came out and started to bite people, and people began to die. Now remember, these people had complained about the Lord and about Moses, but now they're coming to Moses, and they admit, we've spoken against the Lord and against you, but pray, Moses, to the Lord that he take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. Now, right there, that ought to indicate something to us. You're going to have people talk against you. You're going to have people be critical of you and gossip about you. And it's nothing that we can hold in us, because they may come to you. When things start going bad, because it can't go good when you're gossiping and talking and being critical about other people, whether you're saved or not saved. Hello? And so they came to him, and you know what? I think I would have struggled and said, well, you know, you complained about me, you murmured against me, you were critical of me. I'm not praying for you. Does that surprise you? Or are you going to be honest enough to say that may be what I would do too? But Moses didn't do it, and we shouldn't do it either. We should be quick to forgive. And we should take every opportunity to pray for our enemies, like the Bible says in the New Testament, and bless those that persecute us and despitefully use us. But it says, and then the Lord told Moses, Moses prayed, and the Lord told Moses, make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole, and it shall be that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, shall live. So Moses made the bronze serpent and put it on a pole. And so it was, if a serpent had bitten anyone and he looked on the bronze serpent, he lived. So, my question to you today is, was the serpent on the pole a good thing? Yeah, it was a really good thing. Was it a God thing? Absolutely. God initiated it. God directed Moses to do it. Moses was obedient to God, and the result was good. People's lives were saved. But then we fast forward to where Hezekiah was, and we find people looking at this, and now they're worshiping this instrument that God used. There's idolatry. And that's why he breaks it up. He says, no, you can't. It was something God used at the time, but it's not what he is using now. And I want you to know, we at times, I remember a friend of mine who had some real difficult things going on in his life, and he went down to a place called The Cove and prayed, and God really met him there and gave him some great answers that sustained him through really difficult times. And he kept going back and kept going back and kept going back. And I would say to him, you know, why do you always have to go back to The Cove? Because that's where God met me. And I began to realize, and I shared, he was a good enough friend that I could say, hey, you know what? I think you're growing a little off base. You're getting out of line, because is The Cove the only place that God exists? No. But that's where I heard God. That's true, you did. But what happens if you have a situation and your job takes you out of town and you move? How are you going to get back to The Cove? How are you going to hear God if you can't get back to The Cove? See, he had begun to exalt this location, and it began to rob him of the ability to listen for God anywhere and everywhere he was. There was a deception. Was it a good place? Did good happen there? Yes. But it wasn't something to be idolized, something to be exalted and lifted up. And so that was something that needed to change. Put it away. Don't remember the former things. Don't consider the things of old. Let them go and stay fresh with God. It doesn't just happen with instruments or events or locations. It happens with people. It happened in Acts chapter 28. When Bishop Green was here a couple of weeks ago, he spoke to us about what happened with Paul when he was on his way to Rome, and they sailed the ship when they shouldn't have because God had given him a revelation. Remember the four things that Bishop Green spoke to us? He said, yeah, there's a revelation that God gives. But then there is an observation that is trying to rob you of the revelation God has. And then there's an explanation that comes to also rob you of what God has. But you've got to get back to number four, the revelation. And so Paul had spoken to them, and they sailed anyways. And then they were in this terrible storm. Bishop Green went through this and explained it. And yet God had another revelation for him, that the ship would be lost, but no life would be lost. All right, so this is the setup of what we're looking at right here. The ship is broken up. It's gone down. And they're swimming to the island. The island is Malta, all right? Paul and all the other people on the ship. And it says, so when the natives saw, okay, so they swam to Malta. They're cold. They get out of the water. They start to build fires. People from the island are there, and they're helping them. And Paul's gathering sticks. He throws the sticks on the fire. And when he throws the sticks on the fire, the heat from the fire, because it had been so cold, awakens a viper, a poisonous snake, and all of a sudden the snake bites him. So it says, so when the natives saw the creature hanging from his hand, they said to one another, no doubt this man is a murderer. What's happening? They're making a judgment call. They're choosing to judge and say, you know what? This guy has got to be bad news because bad things happen to bad people. You know, we hold fast to this. Well, they deserved it. No, there's a real enemy out there. And so they watch him. They see this serpent fastened to his hand. And what's Paul do? It says, but he shook it off in the fire and suffered no harm. However, they were expecting that he would swell up or suddenly fall down dead. All right, they've made a judgment. They see the serpent, and they say he's a murderer. Now, this will show you how fickle we as human beings are. And he shakes the snake off into the fire. They're waiting for him to die, and he doesn't die. But after they had looked for a long time and saw no harm come to him, they changed their minds and said, he's a god. He goes from a murderer to a god in minutes. And now they're looking to worship him because, you know, if God uses somebody or does something great in somebody's life, all of a sudden we exalt them. Folks, I've got to tell you something. It doesn't matter. And if he were here, he'd tell you the same thing. I truly believe it. Billy Graham. Billy Graham was used by God in astounding ways. But he would tell you, don't look at me, look at God. But it's so easy for us to get our eyes fixed on people that God uses. And we begin to idolize them. We think, I've got to go back to that. And this is the person. You know, would you pray for me? You know, I have no hotline to God. My connection to God is no different than yours, except for how we've chosen to develop it. We have the same connection. But what we've done with it may be different, and it may look a little different in our lives, but mine isn't better, and it doesn't make me better than anybody else. That's why I share with you. I share with you the fact that I go through things. I struggle with things. I slip up and trip up in things. I fall down, but God still loves me, and I'm not better than anybody else. I have a role to fulfill and a part to play, but that doesn't make me better. It's just that this is what God's given to me, just like God's given you something. You're valuable, and we're all valuable in the sight of God, but we don't need anybody more than we need God. He's the one we need the most, amen? And so we see them wanting to worship Paul. And Paul wasn't the one to worship. It was the God that he served. The God that caused him not to die from the snake. The God that caused him not to perish in the storm and in the sea. The same God that's there for you. Then it goes on back in Isaiah 43, verse 19. It says this. It'll spring forth. Shall you not know it? Again, that's like, behold, you got to recognize it. He's saying, recognize it. Be alert to it at the beginning. Then he says, I'm going to do a new thing. It'll spring forth. But then he indicates, you got to know it. You got to know it. You got to look for it. You got to expect it. What are you looking for? Today, in your life as a Christian, if you're not expecting and believing for something, you're going to get exactly what you're not expecting and believing for. Nothing. I would rather have us all with great expectation of seeing things that God's doing, knowing that he'll never fail us, than just living a life of, well, I can't wait till I get to heaven. God wants to show heaven on earth through you here and now, so the people around you will be aware of what's going on, what's happening. And so he says, shall you not know it? I will. Again, God's saying, I'm going to do this. I'm going to make this. It's on him. This is what he's going to do, but you got to recognize it. I'll make what? What's he say? A road where? In the wilderness. I'll make a road in the wilderness. Now, when he says a road in the wilderness was a dangerous, difficult place. We had people that began on the East Coast and they traveled to the West Coast. There were no roads, right? No highways, no nothing. They were just cutting trail. We call them pioneers, right? And how easy was it going? You know, whenever I drive any length of time, I'm always looking at the surroundings and I'm thinking to myself, what was it like for the pioneers? I can't imagine. I'm driving down this road. It's smooth, it's straight, it's safe, it's convenient. And I'm wondering what these people were doing. They're hacking their way through. And they're making a quarter of a mile a day or a mile a day. And how challenging that was. And then, you know, whoever was in the front was cutting trail. And it was difficult. And they always didn't do the greatest job. I mean, there were probably stumps and things. There were ruts of people passing over that same way after the area was cut. But who's cutting trail? Who does this say is cutting trail for you? God's cutting trail for you. What kind of trail is God cutting for you? Smooth. But where is this trail? In the wilderness. Can I tell you something? The Bible talks about this life being like the valley of the shadow of death. This is the wilderness. This is not heaven. This is where it's dangerous and difficult. And God's cutting trails so it'll be smooth for you. You're going to be in dangerous and difficult environments and situations, but God's got a smoothness for you to have as you traverse this. What do you mean? I'm not going to have any obstacles, no opposition. Yeah, you're going to have obstacles. You're going to have opposition. But listen, here's where the smoothness comes. There's a peace. In the midst of all the difficulties, all the dangers, there's a peace. There's a joy. There's a hope, a confident expectation of good. In the midst of the wilderness, God's giving you this. He's cutting trail for you. He's offering this to you and me. Behold, he's doing a new thing. He's not just leading you over the edge. He's leading you into the fullness of what he has for you. And what he has for you, has for me, has for all of us, is the best. But we've got to determine, are we going to follow him? Are we going to follow him? Then it goes on to say, rivers in the desert. Now, these two things are anomalies for their environment. Rivers in the desert were going to be a life-giving, a refreshing, life-sustaining environment. When we look at a road in the wilderness, The only thing I can tell you is, and you know it's coming, snow is coming, correct? Don't live in the land of denial. Snow's coming. And I remember when Debbie and I lived in Colorado, we lived in Denver, and there were times that I would have to go up into the mountains for the hardship of skiing and have to cross the Continental Divide. And going up into the mountain, there were times that they hadn't plowed and the snow was coming down like it does here sometimes, where it's just crazy how much snow accumulates so quickly. And when you're trying to cut trail in the snow and the plow hasn't been there, man, you can get yourself in a whole world of hurt. And I had gone off the road a number of times, and I found out something. I want to share something that is vitally important for people in Colorado and people here in New York and places of snow. Are you ready? This is going to be worth it. This is going to be worth it that you tuned in today, that you came here today. If you see a plow, wait for it. When the plow goes by, get behind it. Makes all the difference in the world. You'll find out this winter. You'll find out if you take that, it'll work well for you. That's where, if we tuck in behind a plow that's cutting trail, why wouldn't we tuck in behind God? He's doing a new thing. It may be new to you, it may be unfamiliar, it may be uncomfortable, but God's bringing you into something that only he can bring you into. Then it goes on to say, and we're going to close it out with the end of these two verses and then two more. In verse 20 and 21, it says, the beasts of the field will honor me, the jackals, the ostriches, because I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my people, my chosen. So what's it saying? It's saying that ostriches, jackals will honor God. Why? Because they see the good things that God's doing for his people. Now, this ought to just indicate to us, if animals, if nature recognizes the good things God's doing for his people, other people will recognize it. God wants other people to see in your life the good things that he's doing in your life, the blessing he's bringing, because it's not just for you, it's for others. Then it goes on to say, this people I have formed for myself, they shall declare my what? Praise. This word praise is the word tehillah. Not tequila, tehillah. All right? Tehillah. It means adoration. It means thanksgiving given to and for God. Now, we're moving rapidly into the one day of the year. We have, in the United States, we have one day of the year that's Thanksgiving. And some people, it's not about Thanksgiving. It's about, you know, pies and turkey and all these other things. But as Christians, we shouldn't be limited to one day. Every day for a Christian is Thanksgiving. Every day we should give thanks because it's God's will. What? Yeah, in the book of Thessalonians, it says it's God's will. Look at this, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. It says in verse 18, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. What? In everything, give thanks. Not for. Don't make that mistake. You don't give thanks for everything that's going on in your life, because not everything that comes to your life is from God. There are some people that are so deceived, and where there's deception, there's what? Loss. There are some people that are so deceived saying, well, you know, everything happens for a reason. I have to tell you, that's deception. Because you don't realize what you're about to say and what you're about to buy into. It does happen for a reason, but not all of them are God's reasons. The enemy has reasons that things are happening in your life. And if you just blanket accept it as, que sera, sera, you're going to be robbed. The enemy does things in your life. God doesn't orchestrate it. And if you just accept everything, you're not going to fight the good fight of faith. And you're going to give in to and receive less than what God has because you've been deceived and now you're experiencing loss. In everything, give thanks. Why? Why is this God's will to give thanks in everything? If it's not from him, why do I give thanks in it? because you know that if it's not from God, God's still going to have his way. You can be thankful to God because when you and I give thanks to God, we're beholding him. We're becoming aware of him like never before. We're expecting from him. And when we lift our expectation from what's going on in our lives to the one who is in charge and control of our lives because we've given him that, all of a sudden we realize the one who never fails, the one who gives every good and perfect gift, the one who works all things out for good. I'm looking to you, Lord. I'm trusting in you. I'm casting the care over on you, and I'm able to give thanks because I'm not alone. You're with me. I'm with you. You're able to work things out for my good, and so I begin to give thanks, and nothing changes, but everything changes in me. All of a sudden, I have a new hope. I have a new peace. I have a new joy. I have a new expectation that God's going to work good out of this. I don't know how, but I do know who. I don't know when, but I know he will in his time. And so we need to give thanks in everything. And then in just to close out in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 through 7 in the New Living Translation, the Apostle Paul writes, don't worry about, what does that leave out? Nothing. Don't worry about anything. Instead, how many of you know you can't worry and then be in faith? It says, don't worry about anything. Pray about everything. Now, I want you to know, sometimes people pray worry or worry pray. If you don't know what I mean, what I'm saying to you is people pray to God, but they pray the problem, not the promise. God already knows the problem. God wants you to have a focus on the promise, that your faith would begin to rise in him, that you would begin to rest in him and receive the refreshing and the revitalizing that he has for you. Tell God what you need, then thank him for all he's done. Tell him what you need and thank him for all he's done. What do you mean? What's he done? If we don't have a list longer than our list of needs of things he's done for us, we're just not paying attention. God, you know, if we only have one thing on our list as a Christian, if I just look at the fact that he saved me, that's more than I deserve. That's better than I deserve. And I'm so grateful for that. And I'm going to heaven, no matter how close to hell this life is like. I'm going to heaven. I can be thankful. I can be thankful in the midst of everything going on because he saved me. Give thanks to him for all he's done. Then when? After you choose not to worry, after you choose to pray and thank God about everything, then, after those are done, then you'll experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and your minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Put a guard on it. When there's a guard on something, how easy is it to take it? This isn't you just trying to hold, I'm trying to hold on to my peace. No, you don't have to. No, you don't have to. You don't worry about anything. You pray about everything. You thank God for all he's done. And then God will put peace in you and guard that peace in you. Well, how does that happen? Because you keep your focus on God. Behold, I do a new thing. It'll spring forth. Will you not know it? God's doing new things, best things, going from glory to glory, and he wants to do it in your life. Like every head bowed, every eye closed. And God won't force his perfect, his best on you. He loves you too much to control you. And so he's waiting for us, each of us, individually to turn to him and trust in him. Invite him. Invite him to be the Lord of our life, to be the master, to guard us and govern us, to guide us. If you've never done that, whether you're here in the sanctuary, whether you're at home, this is the day that God has for you to turn to him, trust in him, and allow him to begin this amazing work in your lives. Is it quick? No. There are some aspects that are quick, but some aspects are process-oriented. He's continuing to work. But it's the best. You'll never have the best apart from God. And so today, if you've never invited Christ to be Lord of your life, I'm going to pray a prayer, and I'm going to invite you to pray with me. Just from your heart, repeat this prayer. We're all going to do it together. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your son, Jesus, who came into this world, lived a sinless life, died on the cross, and paid the price for my sin, and was raised from the dead in victory, glorious and victorious. Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of my sin. Come into my life. Be Lord of my life. From this day forward, I am yours. You are mine. I invite you to govern me and guide me and fulfill your glory in and through my life. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. If you prayed that prayer today for the first time, tell somebody, tell one of the ushers, one of the people that are standing up, let them know, hey, I prayed today. The Bible says you're a new creation in Christ. You're new, but there's a whole newness that you're going to begin to experience. If you prayed at home, let us know. Go to the website, reslifeny.org. Scroll down to where the prayer requests are. And just let us know that you pray today. If you want to give us your name, then we'll be able to pray for you by name. If you want us to contact you, give us your phone number and somebody will get in contact with you this week. This week! How was last Monday? Some of you are like, what are you talking about? I shared with everybody here last Sunday that Monday was going to be the best Monday they had the opportunity to live. Because God had a great plan for them. Now, it's not without challenges. But we got another Monday coming. We got another week coming. And God's already in your week. He has planned great things. But just as God has planned great things for you, the enemy's planned awful things for you, choose God. That's a no-brainer, right? Amen. Would you stand? I have one thing to share with you before we dismiss today. And that is that, you know, we're rapidly heading towards Christmas, and I'm sure you've got all your decorations up, all your presents bought. Good on you. There wasn't a groan here like there was in the first service. But we normally have a Christmas Eve service, and you heard that word normally. This is not a normal year. And so we're going to have a Christmas Eve service, but it's not going to be here. Woohoo! Where are we going to go? Well, I'm expecting you're going to probably be at home. Or someplace, we're going to do a post. We're going to do a virtual online Christmas Eve service. The children are going to have a part. The youth are going to have a part. I'm going to have a part. We're going to have music. And so we're going to post it Christmas Eve day so that you can watch it at your leisure whenever you want to do it. You could use it to invite a neighbor to watch it with you. Yeah, with a mask. Thanks, hon. You know, we're trying to do the best thing we know how to do, the best way we know how to do it. So we'll see how it goes. We're going to do our best. Pray for us. Amen? All right. I just want to bless you. Heavenly Father, I thank you for those that are here, those that are online. I thank you for your presence with them. I thank you for your plan for them, which is for good, with a future and a hope. I thank you for the power you make available to them. And that, Father, as we look to you, as we follow you, as we behold you, and the new things that you're doing, wanting to do, extraordinary, exceptional, supernatural things in our lives, that, Father, there'll be a new strength, there'll be a new vitality, there'll be a new peace, a new joy, a new hope that resonates in us, that can't be taken from us because you are with us and going ahead of us and preparing the way. That, Father, there would be in this year and in the years to come, a prosperity, spirit, soul, and body that would come to your children's lives as we look to you and trust in you and allow you to have your way in us and through us. And we thank you. I thank you, Father, for that blessing coming upon your people ever increasingly in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week. The ushers will dismiss you in rows, so wait for their direction and guidance. Have a great Thanksgiving.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. The battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you,
see you.